on that second down play. He's revved up right now. He knows this is his kind of game. At this point with 8:48, he knows they have to throw the football. Now he's gearing up. He's got some gas in his tank ready to go.
Barely got it away. Gardner's pass is tipped at the line of scrimmage, and that was Jason Atkinson who got a hand on it. It'll be fourth down.
They haven't been able to pick up Jason Atkinson all evening on the blitz inside. They're so conscious of the outside with Buckley and Solari that Atkinson is one-on-one inside. They just have not blocked him. Good scheme by Bob Davey tonight using Jason Atkinson more.
This half, Pete Gardere is only 2 of 7 throwing. Frazier from the 34. Runs into his own man. Then cuts toward the boundary and he'll have it out across the 40-yard line. 46 yards and a kick. Well, National Hockey League action comes your way tomorrow afternoon on ESPN with the Hartford Whalers take on the red-hot Boston Bruins, led by four-time Norris Trophy winner Ray Bourque. That's tomorrow afternoon, 1 o'clock Eastern time. Gary Thorne and Jim Schoenfeld calling the action. Whalers and the Bruins. You're a big hockey fan, aren't you?
I'm a real big hockey fan. I don't know what ends up.
Hey? Surprises me, Michael. I thought you would be.
This is going to become one with it on ESPN now.
Cliff Gross is in at fullback. He gets the carry. Anthony Curl is holding on to him on the tackle. Talked to R.C. Slocum down in his locker room just prior to this ball game, and he said because of the rivalry, and he said because also of the athleticism of Texas, he said, you know, you run into those football teams that put together a ball game where they don't make any errors, and he said, believe me, they're good enough to beat you. And he was concerned about this one tonight, but all of a sudden with that last stop and the clock about to go under 7 minutes to play, a 14-point lead, the Aggies getting ever closer to something their school has never done, and that is have a 12-0 season.
And the shame of the thing, Ron, is that it looks like they won't have a chance for the national title, because if Miami beats San Diego State, Alabama beats Florida, and they meet, then Texas A&M's the odd man out with an undefeated season, 12-0. That's another argument for a college football playoff. You can't do any better than 12-0.
No, you can't. John McAvick. Trying to see if maybe there is a rabbit in a hat someplace, but the time is getting short. Hill, wow, what a double team. One thing that will not happen, even when this thing goes double zeros up there on the clock, these two clubs will just keep hitting each other and keep hitting each other. Because, you know, what we talked about last week with UCLA and USC, all of these kids come from either San Antonio or Dallas or Houston, and they were either recruited together, played against each other, or with each other. As we talked about Rink and also Sam Adams coming from the same high school, but yet going to the two different schools. They know each other well. You don't have to do fire and brimstone speeches to get them fired up for these.
You're right. The war now becomes to recruiting, because Texas has a chance to go out to sign 2023 players. Texas A&M, of course, will get ready for their bowl game, but John McAvick now gets a chance to battle on the war front of the recruiting trails, and he'll add some players here, and he'll get this program going. I'll tell you, he's a solid football coach.
You know what, Mike? The one thing that's going to have to change to help this conference, so we talk about it every week. We see more and more and more Texas kids on every roster of every team, every game we do. What we've seen is sprinkling, but now there seems to be a great number. This is Hill. And he's going to be hit by Malone and stopped just shy of the 45-yard line. And let's get you caught up on what has happened in case you went away or joined us late. Hill and Thomas, 167 yards rushing. Thomas with 3 touchdowns. And look at the next line. 16 blitz, 4 sacks, and 6 pressures. And for Pete Gardere, 9 of 23, 96 yards, and 2 fumbles by the Longhorns. Total of 6 points. One was a real momentum breaker here in the second half.
To me, that was the play of the game.
Thomas breaks off a tackle, puts a head down. He's still on his going to be stopped at the 43-yard line. Gunn and Van Malone on the stop.
Van Malone really came up and delivered a blow to Rodney Thomas, knocked him out of bounds. Lance Gunn had a hold of him. If you're a senior on the Texas team, it's a disappointing feeling. You're going out without a bowl game, but you have the respect of the coaching staff, and you're the start of a new regime, so you're the chance to get it turned around.
Once and once, going to be hit and wrecked by Bo Robinson. And Bo probably looked down at him and said, you hit me in the face earlier, didn't you? Now I just hit you in the side of the head. So with the sack, David Davis will come on to kick it away for Texas A&M.
Texas is going to take a timeout, Ron.
And let's take a break. 4:53 left in the game. Aggies by 14.
Mark's Grocery in Dayton is your hometown neighborhood grocery store with all the extras. Friendly service with free carryouts, well-stocked shelves for easy shopping, and we've just added a movie rental section with new releases for $1.99 a day, and all other movies are three for a dollar per day. But what really sets Mark's apart is our meat market. We only stock the finest cuts of meat, and we make our own sausage and boudin. We also have our own special whole turkeys, both fried and smoked. So for all your grocery needs, come see us at Mark's Grocery, 401 North Main in Dayton.
Hi, folks. At Liberty Dayton Chrysler Plymouth Dodge Jeep Eagle and Liberty, right in the middle of our October sell-a-thon. We've got everything discounted. A 1993 loaded Jeep Cherokee Sport, only $16,500. So what do you do? Pick up the phone, dial 1-800-833-8841, and let's talk your terms.
Take Highway 90 to the 146 bypass in Liberty.
Could determine who goes to the playoffs and who stays home. The Chargers and the Raiders are
in your face.
ESPN Sunday Night NFL.
Hi, this is Chris Myers. Hoping you'll join us later for SportsCenter. We'll show you the Oilers trying to keep their playoff hopes alive, the Cowboys and the Giants and Big D, plus Alabama and Auburn. Be here after the game.
Heisman hopefuls, Garrison Hurst of Georgia, Gino Toretta of number one Miami, and Marshall Faulk of San Diego State, all on Saturday.
As you look at Michael Adams back in punt return position, 27-13 our count. David Davis, about to kick it away. Mike, in the last kick. Texas didn't get the same push this time as that catch made on the run by Adams. And we asked Coach Slocum whether he felt his team had earned the right to play for the national championship.
If Alabama remains undefeated, they're ranked number two, then certainly they deserve a shot at Miami. But if they were to falter along the way, then I hope us being 12-0, if we were successful in playing Texas, and we're 12-0, I hope we'd get the chance and the pollsters would vote to set up a national championship game between two undefeated teams.
Well, like you said, Mike, you can't argue with that logic. You just can't. Here, gathers it in, gives it to Phil Brown, and he will have 12, now 13 yards. Dr. Jerry Punch.
And guys, John Makovic is pulling in all the stops. No huddle from here on out. He said 5 minutes to go, and we still got a shot. He is unbelievable here on the sidelines. What a motivator. He believes they still can pull it out, guys.
Oh, he's got 4 minutes and 37 seconds. Over the middle, has it complete at the 42. Brown out of the backfield.
The pro coaching background of John Mack, of course, has always been a passing coach at Wake Forest. He took them to a successful season. The Chiefs, Illinois, he's always thrown the ball and thrown it well.
Zings it, has it complete. That's Adams down at the 42-yard line.
Got A&M back on their heels a little bit on defense now. with the no huddle. Sure, Bob Davie will crank up a blitz here in a couple seconds. Keeps the substitutes off the field for A&M. They can't bring the extra DBs in.
Blitz again. Bump's going to go long, looking for Duke, just over his hands. Pete Gardere would like to have three passes back in his hand and throw them again from tonight's ballgame, where he has had receivers beyond defensive backs.
Oh, you're right, but I don't think that was his fault. Derek Duke kind of gave up on the play a little bit too soon. Peter Gardere wanted Derek Duke to take off, but he kind of stopped and then tried to pick it back up, and he's just a few feet short of catching that football.
Blitz, and they go with a run, and Brown will have nothing. That's Tackleman, number 58, who steps up and makes the hit justice. The handoff was made. Marcus Buckley also.
Bob Davie brought the blitz, the fine defensive coordinator who was involved in the Baylor job this week and withdrew his name, brought Ray Mickens, number 24, on a blitz.
So Texas A&M has called a timeout, and we'll take it with them. 3:35 left to play. Aggies by 14.
Goodbye, old Regal. Hello, new Regal. The 1993 Buick Regal sedan. This story isn't unusual. There's a real love affair between Buick owners and their automobiles. And the latest J.D. Power & Associates initial quality study ranks Regal Sedan as the best car in its price class. The great American love story belongs to Buick.
She's an 83 with over 140,000 on-road and off-road miles. It must be in and out of it 150 times a day. It's a wonder the doors don't fall off. Only trouble was, when the pig charged, it caved in my door. I only use AC Delco. Cheaper parts can cost you a powerful lot. Of course, so can pigs.
AC Delco parts. It's like buying time.
From precious metals to fashion colors, Cross writing instruments are the perfect gift for everyone on your Christmas list. From your favorite uncle to the kid who delivers the paper. And if you buy any four Cross pens or pencils before December 31st, we'll send you a Medalist ballpoint pen as our gift, which could come in handy. Cross, the perfect gift since 1846.
John Makovic talking with Gary Darnell on the sideline. One of the things, Mike, that has been huge for Texas in the second half, they're only 1 of 5 on third down conversions. Only 4 of 14 for the ballgame. Safety blitz. Lops it. Pinkney just overthrown.
Ray Mickens again, number 24. Brought the extra DB in, and they blitzed him from the wide side of the field to pressure Peter Gardere. Down to one last play for the Texas offense.
Stop the clock with 3:31 left. Safety blitz again. Puts air under this one, heading for the end zone, and it is caught by Adams inside the 15. And Adams got away with a push on that one.
He
you
sure
see
did.
The Aggie defensive back is going nuts. That's Derek Frazier.
Well, 83 is going to push 23, and he got away with it. You're exactly right, Ron. He was able to adjust to the football. Michael Adams on the outside. Texas is still alive with 3:23 on the clock.
34 yards in the pass play. Look in pass. It is intercepted. Aaron Glenn. Touchdown, Texas A&M. 95 yards on the return. down back at the 35.
It got celebrating by Texas A&M. Too many men on the field. What an accomplishment for the Texas A&M football team.
Now, for those who have talked up getting them passed by in the polls, I have a feeling that the Aggies would just say that, you know, if you think they are a cream puff, put them on the schedule and see if they are.
Well, they beat a good Stanford team to start the season.
Comes a call by Joe Thomas.
Personal foul on the scoring team. We're penalized on the kickoff.
You know, that was not for a celebration. Adams, the wide receiver for Texas, stayed on the field for a very long time having words with Frazier, and I think that an altercation must have just, because the flag came from the other end of the field, Mike, and that possibly was it. Kick is perfect. 3:04 left in this one. And let's take one more look at the interception.
Aaron Glenn, number 31. Here's the blitz by Atkinson inside. Just threw it behind his intended receiver, Kenny Neal, number 6. And Aaron Glenn is off to the races. Patrick Bates, 29, trying to take care of the last Texas hope to stop Aaron Glenn.
The only teams to win 12 regular season games. Look at them. A&M in 92. BYU in 84. Nebraska twice, 83 and 71. And SMU in 1935. And as we mentioned, the Aggies had a perfect year in 1939. They won a national championship then. But no A&M team, as you could look at that record right there and see, no A&M team has ever won 12 before.
And as we mentioned, a very young football team, Ron.
They lose 2 on offense and 2 on defense.
R.C. Slocum has done it quietly, too. A gentleman.
Yeah, it's, you know, and the thing is, when you look at his winning percentage of over 80%, that would be a kicked around at the 30-yard line. That's Dan Malone who picks it up. And Dr. Jerry Punch, what do you have for us?
Guys, a minute ago, one of the Texas managers came over to me and said, you know, I don't know which is worse, a broken fibula or a broken heart. This really hurts. This is a big rivalry here. Awfully low here on the Longhorn sidelines. Let's check in over Texas A&M with Adrian Carstrid. Adrian?
Well, Jerry, I've just had this rivalry defined for me as I stand in between a shouting match and they're also throwing some cups and ice and everything else between the A&M bench and some of the Longhorn fans. But the chant down here is 12-0 for the 12th man. There are 20,000 towels out for the fans who made the two-hour trip over from College Station. This really puts a period on the first time that the Aggies have gone 12-0 for the 12th man.
Pete Jardier gets his pass away and just got rid of it. The interception by Glenn, it's the third longest interception return in Texas A&M history. 95 yards is what he's been given officially.
You know, John Makovic, as you look at him in the first year of losing a rivalry game, I'll tell you exactly what he's thinking about, because right now his thoughts are in, you go ahead and enjoy yourself over that other sideline, because I'm going to go recruit myself 2023 football players, and I'll see you here again next year. I'll see you down at College Station. But I'm not going to rest till I get you. And that's exactly what's going to motivate him through recruiting. You can lose this game and you can watch the celebration, but you know in your heart you're going to go get more players and you're going to eventually get this bunch.
And for Buckley, Marcus is out of the ball game and getting a well-deserved rest. He was shaken up a little bit after that interception return.
But he ends it up on a very positive note at Texas A&M Senior out of Fort Worth, Eastern Hills. Will be sacked way back at the 25-yard line.
Willie Mack Garza, the hurt in his eyes, the Texas A&M fans, and R.C. Slocum's thoughts now go to his bowl game. Says, who are we going to play? Who are they going to play, Ron?
In the Cotton Bowl?
Yep.
Mike, the way...
You're Hawks Rock. Who are you going to get there?
That pass is complete. It's McLemore. Steps out of bounds. You know, it is impossible to tell the way they keep battering this thing back and forth with the poles and everything else. Is it going to be Notre Dame or is it going to be Florida State? One of those two, I would assume. Well, tonight's Wrangler, player of the game from Texas A&M, is number 20, Rodney Thomas, and he lives in the shadow, literally, of Greg Hill because Greg starts and then Thomas comes off the bench. But tonight, three touchdowns for him and a really outstanding effort. And I thought he got an A&M team going a couple of times when momentum had gone over to the burnt orange of Texas. So our congratulations to him for his great effort in this ball game tonight. Doug Carter with the carry. Winfred Tubbs is there defensively. Pete Gardier will leave the 40 acres with a lot of records in his pocket. Of course, the records, something he really doesn't care about tonight. He would love more than anything to have closed out his senior year with a victory over Texas A&M, but it's not going to happen. 34-13, Aggies with the 21-point bulge. He was lined up at tailback that time. They had both fullbacks in the game, Carter and Gross. And whoever A&M gets in the ball game, I'll simply say, and I'd love to get your input on it as well, Mike. We saw A&M in the first game of the year. We saw them a couple of weeks ago or 3 weeks ago against Houston. But the improvement and the steady improvement with Pulling at quarterback, they're a new handful as far as what they can do offensively, don't you think?
Ron, this is a good football team that I think could play with Miami. They could play with Alabama. I think they should be ranked number 3 in the country. They're undefeated. They've done everything everybody's asked of them, and they certainly should have a shot at the national championship. And I think it's a shame that they probably will not get that opportunity. If Miami beats San Diego State, Alabama beats Florida, then they're going to meet.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you, Alabama has the defensive backs to match up with Miami, and that'll be a good matchup. But this team is really being overlooked.
Turk
McDonald, the offensive center for the Longhorns, and a hug for his line mate, so to speak, Alan Luther. A couple of seniors that...
You talk about good things that come out of football, there's good things. Team concept. You hear about people and the bad things sometimes. Let me tell you something, the good sure outweighs the bad. College football, college basketball, college sports. A lot of great things happening.
Carter will handle this inside the 35-yard line.
Adrian Carston is kind of the R.C. Slocum look-alike. You better watch for the water bucket.
Score, Texas A&M 34, Texas 13.
Stay tuned for SportsCenter, which follows next. And now for Mike Gottfried, Adrian Karsten, Dr. Jerry Punch, I'm Ron Franklin saying happy Thanksgiving and good night from Austin, Texas.
If you're not familiar with the Nokia 101 cellular phone from Finland, we'd like to break the ice. Nokia is the second largest manufacturer of cellular phones in the world and second largest supplier to the U.S. To see Nokia's breakthrough cellular technology for yourself, go to your nearest dealer and get your hands on a Nokia 101 from Finland. Nokia. It's good to be well connected.
This is the first weekend of the Christmas shopping season.
It's the weekend to be saving.
So make Walmart your very first shopping stop for Christmas savings.
Tis the weekend to be saving.
This Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, you'll find incredible Christmas specials, like a West Bend coffee maker with free juicer, just $17.96, or an Emerson or GPX portable CD player for just $88.
Friday, Saturday, Sunday only.
So this weekend, shop Walmart first and make your Christmas budget last.
At Walmart.
United Airlines now flies you nonstop to London's Heathrow from six U.S. cities. Come fly the friendly skies.
SportsCenter, a holiday feast for the Cowboys. A rookie tries to stage a giant surprise in Big D. The Oilers were out to keep their playoff hopes alive. The Lions looking for an emotional lift. So was Auburn as Pat Dye says goodbye. The Tide tried to stay on a roll, and the Aggies had perfection on their minds against Texas. The 49ers may have let the Eagles go to their head. John nearly lost his with his new team. There's plenty to digest on 60 Minutes of SportsCenter. Next.
Hi, and how are you? Along with Mike Tirico, I'm Chris Myers. Hope you enjoyed your Thanksgiving holiday and glad you could join us for the show. The show will not go on for one of the NFL's most exciting receivers. We'll have that story in a moment. First, the NFL, and Mike, Cowboy fans have a lot to be thankful for.
Yeah, their team has really turned it around under Jerry and Jimmy in the last few years. It was 3 years ago, Chris, that Dallas was 1-15. The Giants won the NFC East that year. But since then, the Giants have won a Super Bowl, but now may be time for the Cowboys to do just that. The change in power atop the NFC East had Dallas, a two-touchdown-plus favorite, hosting the rookie-led Giants in the traditional Texas Turkey Day game. The house that used to be the Landry House. Now Jimmy running the show, and not very hospitable there to the official big hitting early. Michael Irvin's going to catch this Aikman pass, and he's going to have some aches from Greg Jackson. Returning the favor, James Washington on Ed McCaffrey. Big hit there. But Isaac Holt punishing an unsuspecting Howard Cross. And even Emmett Smith gets in the act, showing he can block a little shake on Pepper of the Giants. Now the Giants' opening drive, the rookie quarterback, Kent Graham, his first NFL start, a flea flicker. Well done, Ed McCaffrey, 44 yards, and the Giants seem to be in business. Then Graham, good strong arm, good pass to splitting the defenders, Stephen Baker in the end zone. But the ball squirts through his hands, so it's on to Matt Barr, who's been hot kicking field goals from 35 yards. He hits the upright. It would be that kind of day for the Giants. Their troubles continue now as Graham misses the snap from Bart Oates. The Cowboys were stymied by the Giants' eight-man front defense, holding Emmett Smith in check, stopping him here on fourth and one. On the next possession, Dallas had to settle for a field goal from Lynn Elliott. What a big field goal, 53 yards, a personal best, 9-3, Cal pokes at the break. Then here come the Cowboys on Graham. Norton, Casillas, Haley, you take a name, take a quarterback down. Several of the Giants were mad that the Cowboys were blitzing late in the game when the outcome was decided. And boy, did the Giants get hit by that Dallas defense on the day. They did it defensively in the second half. What about the offense? Well, it was time for Jimmy Johnson to shake loose his big guy, Emmett Smith, who changed his shoes at halftime because the field was slick. Takes the swing out and watch him break out. Breaking tackle with Mark Collins. I'm going that way. 26-yard touchdown, 16-3 Cowboys. Next possession, look at Eric Williams and John Gesick open. A massive hole for an untouched Emmett. 68 of his 120 yards, two touchdowns in 3 minutes. Something worth cheering for the Cowboys as Ray and company run for the sunset. Dallas wins big. 33, the Cowboys' first team to 10 wins in the NFL, and they can clinch a playoff berth if Tampa beats Green Bay on Sunday. The Cowpokes, their third straight Turkey Day win. They're 17-7-1 overall on Thanksgiving. For the Giants, their worst loss in 12 seasons. After the game, Coach Jimmy happy with a strong second half.
I was a little disappointed in the way we started out the ball game. I don't think that we were as sharp as what we needed to be.
Jimmy was really mad at halftime. He's like, man, you know. So we kind of sensed that.
It's been a long time since I've seen open field like that. And it opened up just like we practiced it, and the offensive lineman blocked it very well and went in untouched. Like you said, it was wide open.
It's pretty close to being essential that we're going to be in the playoffs. I mean, it would be naive for any of us to think that we're not going to do that. Home field advantage would be nice.
Well, Aikman helping on the offense, and he's helped out by Emmett, who struggled against the Giants early in his career, the numbers on the left. But now he's averaging over 100 per game against the G-men. He also added his first receiving touchdown this year. By the way, Smith now leads Barry Foster by 30 yards in the chase for the NFL rushing title. Chris?
Now, the Lions were counting on the emotional edge in their Thanksgiving Day ritual at the Silverdome. Former offensive lineman Mike Utley returned for the first time to the site where he was paralyzed from the waist down during a game last year. The Oilers had to overcome that and a short work week after playing their third straight road game. At least this one was in a dome where the Oilers are used to playing. Mike Utley with the thumbs up sign everywhere, and Wayne Fonts overcome with emotion. Utley made the honorary captain for the opening coin toss of this game, and the Lions playing with a lot of emotion. Although a sloppy start and a slow start in this game, Eric Kramer getting the start over Rodney Peete at quarterback, had to call timeout to avoid a penalty for too much time. The Oilers let the clock run out and forced Al Del Greco to kick from 46 instead of 41 yards. That's all that guy needs, right? He's had enough problems, and it's up there, it's out there, but it's not good there. Scoreless game. Then Barry Sanders gets going. This is a tough 7 yards, but against the Oilers defense, they were tough all day. Barry again up the middle, 9 yards on this pickup. Kramer starts to open it up. Herman Moore on the fade. Chris Dishman whistled for pass interference, but then the ball was ruled not catchable. Watch this signal. That's not good.
There is no penalty on the play. The pass was uncatchable.
After all that, there was no call because the ball was not catchable. Then Barry Sanders does get the Lions into the end zone for a 7-0 lead on Turkey Day. 7-3 in the third quarter. Kramer under a heavy rush from Bubba McDowell on the blitz, and William Fuller, the veteran, his first NFL touchdown. The Oilers up 10-7. The run and shoot offense with Kramer trying to bring his team back. Flipping to Herman Moore, who beats Chris Dishman and goes 77 yards, and the Lions are up 14-10. Oilers take their shot with Cody Carlson. Nice leap to haul it down. He's excited. 17-14 Oilers. Then 4 minutes left in the game. Greg Montgomery back to punt, swarmed by Benny Blades from South Florida. He makes it happen. The Lions convert quickly as Kramer flips it to Sanders over the middle on a nice call with 2:57 left. The Lions were up four, but then Carlson moves the team downfield, hitting Haywood Jeffries on a big 37-yard pickup. Then with 1:17 to play, the draw play. Wayne Fonts said to watch for that on his defense, but they didn't watch close enough. White is in, and I always think of Ralph Cramden when I see him. Tough loss. The Oilers do win at 24-21. The Lions have lost five straight home games. Barry Sanders, 54 yards on 22 carries. He's 66 away from reaching 1,000 for the fourth straight season. For the Oilers, now 7-5. The win improves their playoff push.
I think it gives us a big lift with the, you know, with the injuries we had in a short week and being on the road and really kind of struggling today, but still get a win out of this. Now we can, three of our last four games are at home, and hopefully we can get a little bit better.
It was just a great day. The whole day was Thanksgiving, a lot of things to be thankful for. Mike was here. It was just a great day. And the only way to top it off would have been with a victory, but it didn't happen.
The Lions play hard, but run into a potential playoff team, and the Oilers like it under glass. They've won 6 of 8 games in dome stadiums, just 1 out of 4 outside with the elements. The 3 of their 4 remaining games are in the Astrodome. The only away contest is at Cleveland.
One other NFL story, Al Toon. He caught a pass in all but 4 games during his New York Jets career, but that career has come to an end. As we first reported from our Chris Mortensen, Toon is being forced into retirement for medical reasons, the official announcement coming Friday afternoon. Toon's big hands and big frame led to big plays after being the Jets' top pick out of Wisconsin, 1985. an All-American in college, became a Pro Bowler in the NFL, averaging nearly 13 yards a catch, one pass catch in 101 straight games. But Toon has been plagued by five serious concussions over the last few years, the latest causing vertigo, which produced headaches and nausea. That concussion was suffered against the Denver Broncos. No wide receiver had more catches in his first five seasons. Toon's career ends with 517 catches, behind only Don Maynard in Jets history. The Jets will honor the remaining 2 years and $2.75 million left on Al Toon's contract after he retires Friday.
And the Jets, of course, making the change at quarterback. Ken O'Brien, the starter this week. Later on the hour-long SportsCenter, Earl Bruce, angrier than Spike Lee, admits some wrongdoing, but is challenging Colorado State. We'll have the details.
Another coach on the way out, Pat Dye. His finale against Alabama. The Tide looking to close out a perfect season and dance towards the SEC title game. Then another team looking to maintain perfection. A&M highlights on the Aggies and the Horns. Stay with us.
Look, it keeps time, and it grates cheese.
While some watchmakers brag about their new inventions,
it is a stopwatch and mousetrap.
Loris makes practical watches. Water-resistant with stopwatches, alarms, calendars, quick-reading graphic timers, and now the Loris Vector. A digital compass built into a precision chronograph. So forget...
Let it spray 9000! Quartz accuracy never tasted this good!
Stick with Loris, the only time worth keeping.
Panasonic presents a unique and highly evolved smooth operator. The new Smooth Operator 2 with float control is the only razor to unite the comfort of twin independent floating heads with the closeness of a warm, wet shave. Don't try this with any plugged-in razor. The new Smooth Operator wet dry razors from Panasonic. Smoother than you ever thought you'd be.
SportsCenter is brought to you by Loris, the only time worth keeping. And by the Michelob family of beers, because some days are better than others.
Thanksgiving Day football memories. November 25th, 1971, number one Nebraska at number two Oklahoma. Johnny Rogers taking the punt and racing.